So good morning, everyone. Keeping with our vision of developing ethical leaders with entrepreneurial and global mindset, striving for sustainability and inclusive growth, an experiential course was designed in 2017 to inculcate leadership skills in our students. It was named LEAD, an acronym for Leadership Experience and Attitude Development. It was launched by Professor Debashish Chatterjee, an eminent management thinker, leadership expert, and currently director of IIM Kozhikode. Success is not a place at which one arrives, but rather the spirit with which one undertakes and continues the journey. Today, we are fortunate to have with us Mr. Kuntal Joysher, a high-end computer science professional and an accomplished mountaineer who has scaled Mount Everest twice. We are launching the LEAD course for this batch of 2021-23 with his special address titled Climb Your Own Everest. I would now like to request our director, Dr. H. Chaturvedi, to please deliver the welcome address.
Thank you, Dr. Manasi Chaudhary. My faculty colleagues, member of the alumni community and the batch of 2021-23. We are meeting on the occasion of launching of the experiential course LEAD. And we are fortunate to have someone who has done a lot of good work in creating an ecosystem or creating a backdrop for the young Indians to learn leadership skills. And it is not first time. It has happened many times in the world. Management is a discipline which is not limited only to books or classroom lectures. You cannot learn leadership and management only by books and classroom lectures. You need to know whatever is happening around the world, whatever happening in warfares, in sports, athletics. Recently, you must have heard about successes of Indian sports persons in Tokyo Olympic. So sports, adventure, army, these are some of the professions and vocations where a lot of leadership skills are required. And management scholars have quoted in their lessons on team building and leadership from the Second World War stories or the expeditions to different mountains, and also from the successes and failures of internationally renowned sports persons. We are fortunate to have a very renowned mountaineer of our country, Mr. Kuntal Joysher. And there can be question from the young people that what can we learn from mountaineering or the story of Mr. Kuntal Joysher, who has scaled Mountain Everest twice, once from the side of Nepal and the second time from the side of China. I would like to just share one information that efforts of human beings to scale Mount Everest started way back in 1921. So it is almost 100 years. The biggest mountain it is being attempted by human beings to scale the peak of the Mount Everest. First expedition was made in 1921, and first successful expedition was led by a Britisher, John Hunt. And you might have read the story of Sir Edmund Hillary, a New Zealand mountaineer, and a Nepalese mountaineer, Tenzing Norgay. They were the first mountaineers who have scaled the peak on May 29th, 1953. And there were 320 porters with them who accompanied them. Indians, mountaineers first time scaled the peak in 1965. It was led by Colonel Chima. So mountaineering has been a global sports or adventure sports, and all over the world, young people, they have been doing it. Even some physically challenged Indians or foreigners, they have scaled Mount Everest. I would like to say that leadership is not confined to the life and work stories of CEOs leading different companies. Leadership is needed everywhere. It is needed in schools and colleges. It is needed in government. It is needed in politics. It is needed in society. It is needed in families. Leadership is not an end itself. It's a journey. Everyone has to learn the skills and competencies required for a leader to lead any entity, any organization, any company, any college or any university. So I think today is a great opportunity for all of us. And Sir Edmund Hillary, as well as Mr. Kuntal Joysar, they have showed that all of us can develop leadership skills and to scale our own Mount Everest. As I told you, everyone is a leader. We can all climb the mountain in our respective lives, mountain of challenges, difficulties, and failures. You just need to believe in yourself and tell yourself that you can do it. You need to take action and perseverance in the face of adversity. And you need to learn to unleash the power of the people you work with, who can help you climb mountains you could never have climbed on your own. So leadership required a very cordial relationship with the team members, followers. One cannot achieve everything himself or herself. I think today's lesson, when we are launching the LEAD experiential course, will be very useful. And I hope that the stories of Mr. Kuntal Joysar, who has addressed several conferences and particularly TED, one of the TED conference, it is available, very popular videos which are available on YouTube. I think his story of scaling Mount Everest mountain will be very relevant, very useful for all of our students, all of our teachers, all of our staff, all of our alumni. Thank you, Mr. Kuntal, for finding time today to address our community, BIMTEC fraternity. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Our guest for today, Mr. Kuntal Joysar, is an alumnus of Vivekananda Institute of Technology, Mumbai, and USC Viterbi School of Engineering, Los Angeles. His insatiable passion for mountaineering has led him to climb mountain ranges across the world, including the Western Ghats near Mumbai, the Northern Ice Cap in Chile, and the Nepalese and Indian Himalayas. As mentioned by Dr. Chaturvedi, he has climbed to the top of Mount Everest from both the Nepal side in 2016 and the China side in 2019. He is a well-respected photographer, and his work has been published in the National Geographic, BBC Earth, Space.com, Himalayan Journal, The Outdoor Journal, Traveler Trails, Indian Mountaineer, and several other newspapers and magazines across the world. He has been named as one of India's top 30 fitness influencers alongside Honorable Prime Minister Shri Narendra Modi ji, Yoga Guru Baba Ramdev, Bollywood actor Akshay Kumar, and champion cricketer Virat Kohli, among others. So, you know, it's a privilege for us to have him with us here today. He has been featured on the covers of magazines across India and the world, and has also been featured on the TEDx platform multiple times. Mr. Joysar is an athlete ambassador for the Italian company Save the Duck and represents them while climbing mountains across the world. He continues to train hard both mentally and physically, and his latest project is to compete in a natural bodybuilding competition and follow it up by climbing the 7 summits, both in a 100% vegan fashion in the next 2 to 3 years. In addition to his dedication to mountaineering and bodybuilding, he is passionate about 3 causes: raising awareness about the disease of dementia, spreading the message of veganism, and supporting the education of the underprivileged in Nepal. So, ladies and gentlemen, It's going to be an extremely captivating session with Mr. Joysher as he shares his experiences and learnings with all of us. Over to you, Mr. Joysher.
Thank you. Thank you so much. Dr. Chaturvedi, really appreciate your welcome address and really identify and echo a lot of words that you have said, because I have lived a lot of those words through my last 12 years of journey, and hoping to share more stories from my journey with all the students. I'm just going to share my screen and... And I'm going to start with this particular photo itself. This is from May 19th, 2016. And this was about 9:15 a.m. in the morning. I was standing on the very top of Mount Everest. And I know I'm starting my talk by sharing when I reached the top of Everest, but I'm going to go back and share how it all started. But this photo is something that I remember every moment distinctly. I remember every second distinctly. I had just seen the top of Mount Everest, and my Sherpa was standing in front of me, and he was like waving at me and calling me. But I had started crying, and I remember as the tears flew from my eyes, they were right away freezing the moment they reached my cheeks. It was about minus 40 degrees Celsius. I was tired, I was cold, and I was exhausted. But at the same time, I was exhilarated. I was filled with emotion and filled with joy. I had reached the top of Mount Everest, the biggest dream of my life. And believe me, if someone had told me back in 2009 that Kuntal, you are going to leave your job and go on this journey of climbing the toughest and tallest mountains of the world, I would have said, are you out of your mind? That was simply not something which was part of my journey or part of my life plan or anything. And so I will kind of, you know, before I get into my journey itself, I wanted to share one backstory so that you get a bit more understanding of how this journey started in some sense. In October of 2010, after about a year and a half of climbing mountains in India, doing small treks, I decided that I wanted to see Everest. I wanted to see the tallest mountain in the world. Remembering what Dr. Chaturvedi said in his address, where he said Sherpa Tenzing and Sir Edmund Hillary climbed to the top of Everest in 1953. For me, I always remember as a kid growing up, I always thought that Sherpa Tenzing was actually an Indian. I didn't even know that Nepal and India were different countries. I always thought Nepal was part of India, you know, back when I was growing up as a kid. And so I always thought, wow, this guy, he's my Superman. Sure, you know, I always see these cartoons of Superman, Spider-Man and Batman. But for me, he's like real life Superman. So as a kid, I was inspired by Sherpa Tenzing because he proved that nothing in this world is impossible, including climbing to the top of Mount Everest, because he was literally the first human being to get there. So I got inspired by his story. And when I, you know, had worked for about 10 years in corporate life and I had enough money, I decided, hey, you know what? I want to see Mount Everest. I want to see that place that inspired so many dreams in me. So I signed up for the trip and I landed in Kathmandu. I took this short 20-minute flight to a place called Lukla. Lukla is a small village, which is also one of the most dangerous airports in the world. So we landed in Lukla, and from there we walked for about 10 days through some of the most spectacular Himalayan scenery that I had ever seen in my life. And we finally reached Everest Base Camp. And I remember reaching Everest Base Camp and like looking up and I'm like, where's Everest? One of the biggest ironies of Everest Base Camp is that you can't see Everest from Everest Base Camp. So it was like such an anticlimactic moment for me at that point. But luckily our team had set up this short detour where we were going to be staying at this place called the Pumori Base Camp. This mountain that you see in the photo is a mountain called Pumori. And Pumori is also known as the daughter of Everest. It is diagonally opposite of Everest. And it offers some of the most spectacular views of Everest that you can find anywhere in the entire region of Everest. So we had, you know, we were staying here a couple of nights. And I remember one of the evenings, we were all gathered in the dining tent. This is how a typical base camp of any mountain looks like. You have a few climber tents, and you have a kitchen tent, and you have a dining tent, and that's pretty much where our life gets spent for almost about 60 days. So I was here in the dining tent, and we were just visiting as like trekkers, not even climbers. We were chit-chatting, exchanging photos, exchanging stories, and just life was really very, very good. And I remember one of the Sherpa guides started shouting my name. When you are in the mountains, if someone's shouting your name, it's almost always never good. So I was a little scared, and I quickly ran out. And I asked, what happened? And my Sherpa said, sir, up Everest ki taraf dekho. And I turned around, and this is the view I was faced with. The last rays of sunset were directly falling on Everest. Every other mountain, Everest is a gigantic range. It is the tallest mountain on the planet. Please understand. Every mountain around was in the colors of gray, blue, gray, black. But Everest in the middle was burning golden in color, as if someone had lit all the snow on fire. And when I saw Everest this way, I'm going to, you know, like use a Bollywood dialogue here to, have, you know, kind of describe how I felt. But wo bahut famous dialogue hai, pehli nazar mein pyar ho gaya. And for me, it was, you know, pehli nazar mein Everest ke saath pyar ho gaya. And my wife till date, you know, rues the fact that I went to Everest base camp and fell in love with Everest, the mountain, and that she became second or third priority in my life. But that story I will, you know, share later. But that day I also promised myself one thing. As much as this goal looks impossible, I am going to come back one day and stand on top of this mountain. And that is the mindset that I went back home with. And that is where really my entire journey kickstarted. And I also want to take a, you know, kind of a step back here and share one of the biggest takeaways of my entire life, of the last 12 years at least, is that find your Everest. Get inspired and find your Everest. You know, find that thing that's going to drive you. For me, when I found my Everest, I found that focus and that relentless drive to go on the journey to pursue it. And just taking a step back here, I still have, you know, a fair bit of learnings to share. But if there is one learning that you can take back, I would ask each one of you to take a step back and figure out what your Everest of life is. Take some time out today, tomorrow, day after, whenever you can, and figure out what your Everest of life is. And believe me, it gave me that passion and it gave me that focus. And I'm pretty sure it will also give you the same passion, the same focus to go on this journey. But as I came home, I also quickly realized that Everest is at 29,000 feet. 29,000 feet is also the altitude where a jet cruises. Anytime you now take a flight and the flight is at cruise altitude, the captain says, you know, seatbelt nikal do. Remember, that is the height I have actually physically been to. And, you know, temperature generally says always minus 50 degrees Celsius, minus 55 degrees Celsius. So real mein is altitude pe utna temperature hota hai. So one thing I quickly realized is ke ye to bahut hi risky aur bahut hi impossible journey jaisa feel hona shuru ho raha hai. And why not? This is, you know, what happens to people on Everest. I still remember the first time, that very trip that, you know, I showed you the photos of Pumori base camp. I remember entering the dining tent and these three photos, they had been blown up into massive pictures and they had been stuck on the side of the wall. And I was shocked when I looked at these pictures and I asked my expedition leader, do you really want us to climb Mount Everest? This does not look like a very good marketing tactic. And he's like, Kuntal, I don't care about marketing. If you are going to make any mistake on the mountain, I will also have to put your photo on this wall. That's what happens to people on Everest. There are so many things like haze and hape. Haze is high altitude cerebral edema and hape is high altitude pulmonary edema. Cerebral edema means there's a lot of swelling on your brain, and pulmonary edema literally means that you are drowning in your own lungs fluid. If that is not enough, there's frostbite. These pictures you see are of climbers who have gotten frostbite on the mountain. And if frostbite is not enough, there's hypothermia. Hypothermia is a condition where you are so cold, where you are so cold that your body actually starts feeling that it is warm. I have been on an expedition where a German climber got hypothermic. And at 28,000 feet, he started removing his clothes. And when we were talking to him, he was saying, "Main to beach pe baitha hoon." You know, that was kind of, you know, his mindset, that he felt as if he was sitting on the beach. It's you're so cold that you just have no clue what is happening to your body. Or for that matter, hypoxia, where there is just lack of oxygen to your entire body, including your brain, which causes hallucinations and which just causes you to completely have no idea what's going on. And finally, all of these conditions sometimes together leading to death. And so I had already read about this, and my family had also read about this, and many of them told me, "Kuntal, please don't do this. It is too risky. What if you end up dying on the mountain? What, you know, those kind of things." But a lot of people just came to me and said, by the way, back then I was also 110 kilos. I was very unfit. I also come from a Gujarati business background. So there is no predisposition to climbing any mountains. For whatever I remember, the last 100 years of, you know, my ancestry, my grandfather, his grandfather, even if they have to climb one floor, they would take an elevator. So for someone like me to kind of think of climbing Mount Everest, everyone in my friend circle, my family, all, you know, far off relatives, they said, "Tu pagal ho gaya hai." That was, you know, number one thing. And number two thing was, "Impossible hai, tu nahi kar paane wala hai. Ye, you know, ye sab chhod do. This is not some, you know, this is not our forte. Our forte is business, focus on that." And so many things were happening. Whatever I had read, I always thought this is risky, this is impossible. And look, I am going to, you know, say something which I have looked up on the internet, or which probably a lot of you folks already know. But अगर आप वर्ड इम्पॉसिबल को भी लोगे तो वो वर्ड इम्पॉसिबल भी अगर उसको ब्रेक किया तो इट रीड्स आई एम पॉसिबल. तो वन ऑफ माय बिगेस्ट टेक अवेज ऑल्सो फ्रॉम दिस जर्नी हैज बीन, व्हेन यू फाइंड योर एवरेस्ट, बिलीव मी, इट्स गोइंग टू लुक इम्पॉसिबल. नंबर वन, इट्स गोइंग टू फील सुपर 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 रिस्की. एंड इफ इट डजंट फील आइदर ऑफ देम, इट इज प्रोबेबली नॉट योर रियल एवरेस्ट एनी वे. तो अगर वो रियल एवरेज एक बार फाइंड कर लिया तो इट विल फील बोथ. एंड आई कैन टेल यू फ्रॉम एक्सपीरियंस दैट शो अप विद द एटीट्यूड दैट आई एम पॉसिबल. बस अगर वो एटीट्यूड लेके तुम शो अप करोगे और जर्नी किक स्टार्ट करोगे तो एटलीस्ट हाफ द बैटल इज वन राइट देयर एंड देयर इटसेल्फ. फ्रॉम हाइंडसाइट आई कैन से, व्हेन आई डिसाइडेड इन माई माइंड दैट आई एम गोइंग टू क्लाइम एवरेस्ट, दैट दिस इज माई एवरेस्ट ऑफ लाइफ एंड दैट आई शोड अप, दैट वॉज ऑलरेडी हाफ द बैटल वन. So this is one of a very, very, again, another big takeaway from my journey. But then I also remembered the words of this very gentleman. This guy's name is Tim Rippel. Tim is also one of a very famous expedition leaders in the world. He has a reputation of putting people on top of Everest for almost repeated 20 years with an impeccable safety record. And his words to me were, "Kuntal, to climb to the top of the world, you need a top of the world mind and you need a top of the world body." And in 2010, when I was starting out, I knew that I neither had a top of the world body and I neither had a top of the world mind. Dono missing tha. And I quickly realized that if I have to climb to the top of Everest, I have to go on a journey to build both the top of the world mind and top of the world body. And so I started that journey. And I do want to briefly share that I went on a journey for about 5 years, and this journey, there were three main focuses which I truly believe were foundation of my Everest journey, or I truly believe could be a foundation of any journey on this planet. And my first foundation was that of training, and training could mean in my context physical fitness training and mental fitness training. And so I ensured that for the next 5 years, I built that top of the world body and I built that top of the world mind. And that started with a lot of training. but second was also skill building. Because, you know, आप लोग अभी मैनेजमेंट स्टूडेंट्स बन रहे हो या फिर एग्जाम्पल किसी को डॉक्टर बनना है, किसी को इंजीनियर बनना है, you have to still do a course, you have to build skills. बहुत जरूरी है. And in my case, my life depended on it. So I had to become a reliable mountaineer. I had to become a safe mountaineer. I had to become a skillful mountaineer. So I also spent a lot of time doing mountaineering courses, learning skills on the field, learning skills from mentors, learning skills from co-climbers. Kafi sara time. And even today, after 12, 13 years of climbing, I continue working on these pieces. So this is not like maine skill build ki aur khatam ho gaya. I am continuing to still build skills. And finally, I think a very, very big chunk, which is experience. I still remember 2002, I graduated from USC School, Viterbi School of Engineering in Los Angeles. And as a fresh engineer, I started writing code. If today, 20 years later, today's Kuntal, agar wo 20 saal purane Kuntal ka code dekhega na, that code was really, really bad. That code was not mature at all. That code was not efficient at all. That code was not good in any sense. So ye 20 saal ka experience ka journey hai, which has made me who I am today, so that I can look back upon that junior Kuntal and say, yeah, this is shitty code. This is not good code at all. And so it is super important. And in my case, especially in mountaineering, it also meant climbing in dark, climbing in snow, climbing in ice, climbing in rock, climbing with my one hand tied behind. So that I could simulate a case where agar main gir gaya aur mera ek haath toot gaya, then how am I going to climb in that situation? Or for that matter, climbing without food and water for 1 day or 2 days. When I'm here in Mumbai and when I'm training in Mumbai, I do a lot of this simulation so that imagine if I cannot bear any of this at sea level, how am I going to bear at 28,500 feet on top of Everest? Wahan toh things are going to be 1,000 times harder than what it is at sea level. So all of these situations that I kind of imagined myself falling on Everest, I simulated all of them at sea level. And I built a lot of experience by climbing 5,000 meter mountains, 6,000 meter mountains, 7,000 meter mountains. I climbed in Himalaya, I climbed in Alps, I climbed in South America, I climbed in US, I climbed everywhere across the world to just kind of get used to and build a lot of experience, something that would eventually pay off when I went and climbed Everest. So these three were some of the biggest foundations of my training journey. And I'm not going to get into details of how I physically trained or how I mentally trained. You can, if you have any pointed questions, I can definitely answer those at the end. But this also brings me to my next takeaway, which is I truly believe there are no shortcuts to the top. And there is no substitute for hard work, just as simple as that. You have to put in the time, you have to put in the effort, and you have to go through this journey. And I'm not, you know, standing here and saying that you just have to hard work, you also have to smart work. Because there's also sometimes efficient ways of doing a certain things, and then there's sometimes just a brute force way of doing a certain thing. So, kabhi kabhi brute force kaam mein aata hai, but kabhi kabhi those efficient ways are also smarter. And when you find an efficient way, it's not necessarily a shortcut. So that is, you know, something I kind of, you know, just also wanted to point out that you have to go through this grind. You have to go through this entire phase. And I continue to go through this phase even today as I find my new Everest in life and as I go and climb those new Everest in life. And finally, after 5 years of preparation, I was finally ready to climb to the top of Everest. And I signed up to climb to the top of Everest. For a climb in 2014, I reached the base camp. This was about April 13th or April 14th. And we had done some basic climbing around the base camp. And then I remember April 18th, early morning, as I walked into the dining tent, Tim, who was my expedition leader, was glued to the radio and his face looked very grim. And I asked him what happened. And Tim said, 17 Sherpa guides have died in the single largest accident that has ever happened on Everest till now. And in that moment, I was a bit shocked. But in my mind, it was still going, haan, log to marte hai Everest pe pure time. What's the big problem? I want to still climb my mountain. I still want to achieve my dream. And then few hours later, as my Sherpa team entered the camp and 9 of them were all safe and they were all fine, the lead Sherpa of the team, who had climbed Everest already 11 times, this is, you know, a rock star Sherpa. He came inside the dining tent and he started crying, saying that we missed the accident by 5 minutes. And I literally saw my brothers, my mamas, my chachas, my cousins being crushed under big boulders of snow and ice in front of me. And we just missed it. And he was absolutely shocked. And his only thing was, who will take care of my parents if I had died? Who would take care of my children? And those are the only questions. And that's when it hit me that this is a humanitarian tragedy that has happened here on Everest. And for the next 1 week, we discussed a lot of pros and cons of still climbing the mountain, given that there was no safe route on the mountain. And look, safety here is all relative. Risk here is all very, very relative. Because when you are climbing Everest, it's an inherently unsafe and a risky activity. But within that framework, we still manage risk and we still, you know, figure out what's the most safest way of getting to the top of the mountain. And within that framework, unfortunately, that year, we were not able to find a safe route. We were not able to manage risk better. And so after 1 week of a lot of discussion and debate, it was finally decided that Everest was going to be cancelled for the first time in history of climbing. So 2014 season on the south side of the mountain was cancelled and we all had to turn around and go home. And for me, it was the biggest dream of my life and it came crumbling down in front of me. And I had to come home and I had to stay focused. I had to stay very, very positive because I wanted to make another attempt at this mountain. And that also meant that I had to train really, really hard for the next entire year. And while, you know, I'm saying here that one takeaway was that be positive, be focused. When I say be positive, I don't mean that you have to be happy all the time or you have to have a smile on your face all the time. Happiness is an emotion which is a very temporary emotion. Sometimes you are going to be happy. Sometimes you are going to be sad. Sometimes you are going to be in a different emotion. These are all emotions that are up and down. But through all these emotions, you can still at an attitude level be very positive. That no matter what, I am going to get through this and I'm going to make it through this. So that is the kind of attitude that I had through the entire year 2014 and 15, where I stayed focused, where I stayed positive, where I trained really, really hard. And I finally went back to climb Everest in 2015 again. And just to take some time and describe how Everest is climbed in stages. It takes about 60 days to climb to the top of Everest. And there are three stages mainly. Stage one is where you walk to the base camp of Everest. And it takes about 8 to 10 days. Stage two is where you acclimatize to the various altitudes on the mountain using a strategy called climb high, sleep low. What you do is the base camp is at 18,000 feet. And for the first few days, you spend nights at 20,000 feet. And then you come back down. The whole point is that when you go to altitude, your body starts acclimatizing at that altitude. But at the same time, at altitude, your body is also dying. So you can't stay at that altitude forever. You have to come down so that you can eat more food. You are in thicker oxygen and your body can recover. The next time when you go high up, you go to 22,000 feet and spend a few nights and you come back down again. And then finally, you go all the way to 24,000 feet, spend a few nights and you come back down. And this stage is the most crucial stage of climbing Everest. And it takes about 30 to 35 days to finish this stage. And finally, you wait for appropriate weather window to come up. Throughout the year, there are winds of almost about 250 to 300 kilometers on top of Everest. So you have to wait for the right moment where these winds go down to almost 30 to 50 kilometers per hour, which is sometimes in mid-May or sometimes in late May. And then you kind of decide to get to the top and come back down. And that stage, which is the final stage, takes about 8 to 9 days to get to the top and back down. And total kind of, you know, taking about 60 days to get to the top of this mountain and back down. In 2015, we had finished stage one very easily. Getting to the base camp is very straightforward. And stage two, acclimatizing to the various altitudes on the mountain, we had finished almost 50% of it. And on April 25th, we were stationed at the base camp. And this was about 11:55 in the morning. And I remember sitting in the dining tent and my chair was shaking. And having lived in California, I even get a sense of when it's a 3 or a 4 magnitude earthquake. So in my mind, this almost felt like an earthquake. So I was, you know, telling all my friends, hey, this feels like an earthquake. And I remember one of the friends telling me that maybe you have a case of altitude sickness and this is all happening in your brain. And which could also be true. When you have altitude sickness, you could feel that something is happening, but that could just be happening in your mind. But about 5 to 10 seconds later, the entire dining tent was shaking and we knew we were in the middle of a massive earthquake. We were in the middle of a 7.9 magnitude earthquake that hit Nepal, the largest to hit it in a century. And imagine you are standing on a glacier and it is like a big swing swaying from one end to the next end. That's how massive this earthquake was. This earthquake also induced a big avalanche that followed. And I'm going to show you actually what exactly happened with the avalanche. And then I'm going to share a little bit more about the story itself.
Fuck! Come under my jacket. Come under my jacket. Are you okay? Yeah.
You all right?
Yeah.
So what had happened is actually a massive avalanche came from Pumori. And before we knew about the avalanche, it was the whole sky was filled with avalanche. From left of the sky to the right of the sky, the entire sky was filled with this tsunami of snow and ice, and it was less than 3 seconds away from us. In that moment, when I saw that avalanche, I did not think that I was going to die. I was actually very certain that I was going to die. So I actually took a step back. I said all my prayers and I said, this is it, you know, my life is going to end. While I don't want to die, but I can't really run on the left, I can't run on the right, I can't run anywhere. And this is nature. This is, you know, what mountains and nature is about. And I had actually, you know, kind of surrendered. But three of us, there was a German mountaineer named Yost Kabush. There was a Japanese mountaineer named Taro Yamagata and myself. Three of us, we quickly ran and we hid behind a tent. And this massive avalanche hit us. And in about 10 seconds, I thought that I was going to be covered in about a couple of feet of snow. And that couple of feet of snow will turn into concrete within 10 to 15 minutes. And we'll be buried alive. We'll die a very slow death. But after 10 seconds, I realized that there was only 2 inches of snow on my body. And so I thought probably I am going to make it alive out of this. But the next thing that happened is I just could not breathe at all. I was trying to suck in air, but I just couldn't suck in any air. And like I tried a couple of times to kind of, you know, just ensure that I'm not panicking. But I was not panicking and no air. I was not able to suck in any air. Almost as if someone had taken a plastic bag and had put it on my face and was trying to kill me. And in that moment, the climber next to me, Yost, he opened his jacket and he said, Kuntal, you can come inside my jacket and breathe. Something that you could see in the video. And so I went inside his jacket and there were still ambient pockets of air inside his jacket. And so I was able to breathe and we were all able to manage for the next 2.5 minutes. We realized quickly after the avalanche that our entire base camp, at least our portion of base camp, was completely devastated. Not a single tent was standing. Every single tent had disappeared. Our biggest tent, the dining tent, had also disappeared. And it was massive destruction at the base camp. Luckily, no one in my team died. No one in my team even got injured. But we realized that about 21 people at the base camp had died. And more than 70 to 80 people at the base camp were injured. We ran to the medical tent with some hot water bottles. Because we are not trained rescuers, but we can help in whatever way we can, which is by giving some medical supplies and some hot water. And I still remember reaching the medical tent and realizing it's almost like a war zone. All these dead bodies coming in, people with broken hands, people with broken feet. I remember a Japanese couple walked in and the lady's face, half of the face was just missing, skin and bones. Probably she got hit by a big, massive boulder. And we just kept hearing all these gruesome stories. And then we even made a phone call to Kathmandu and we quickly realized that 10,000 people were dead. 5 lakh people were homeless. This was no longer a mountaineering tragedy, but this was a tragedy of unprecedented levels. And in my mind, it was time to kind of pack up and go home. And I spoke to my Sherpa leader. And both of us kind of concurred that this is it. We need to all turn around. We all need to go home. Focus of Nepal needs to be rebuilding the country, not people climbing Everest. And if any more accidents happen, then entire world's focus becomes Everest. So finally, we decided to kind of cancel the expedition for second year in running and come back home. And this time when I came back home, I remember so many people telling me, Kuntal, you just don't have what it takes to climb this mountain. 2014 mein gaye, wapas ghar aa gaye. 2015 mein gaye, wapas ghar aa gaye. And they had zero clue what was actually happening on the mountain, that we were not even getting to attempt the mountain. And then my family was really worried, knowing that 45 people had died on the mountain and that I had miraculously escaped a near death. They were also like, don't go back again to the mountain. But for me, when I took a step back, I realized that I am alive. I have gotten a second chance. When I saw the avalanche, I had actually said my prayers. So I was ready to die. So now all the rest of my life is anyways a bonus. All rest of my life is a second chance. And I cannot be wasting this second chance at all. And this is not the time to give up, but this is the time to face all this adversity, to face all this challenge. It is my dream. It is no one else's dream. If I give up on my dream, then all the regrets for rest of the life are only going to be mine, no one else's regrets. So I was very focused and I said, no matter what, I am going to go back again and try climbing this mountain for the third time. And that's what I did. I decided to train again for an entire year. For me, it was just one inconsequential year. But for people in Nepal, 10,000 dead, 5 lakh injured, homeless. That was like a very, very, very difficult time for people in Nepal. For me, it was just one inconsequential year. I just had to dig deep, stay focused, and keep training and go back to climb the mountain. And finally, I came back to climb the mountain again in 2016 for the third time. I remember walking through the valley, through the Everest Valley. And when you are walking through the Everest Valley, you are living in tea houses. And I remember I stay in the same tea houses every year. So third time when I was going back through these tea houses, the lodge owners would meet me and say, you are literally mad. You are like one of the most pagal persons we have seen, you know, in this world, who came in 2014, who came in 2015. And in spite of what happened in 2014 and 15, you are now back to climb this mountain in 2016. And they were like, why do you expect a different outcome this year? 14, 15, 40 people died. You know, why do you expect anything different is going to happen in 2016? But for me, this was my dream. This was my goal. This was my passion. And we got to the base camp. We finished stage one. We finished stage two very, very uneventfully. There were no events whatsoever. We got to stage three. We got a great weather window. We looked at Indian Army weather reports. We looked at the Swiss weather reports. We looked at the American weather reports. And all of them said May 19th is a great date to reach on the top of Mount Everest. And we finally started our journey. We finished 90% of our stage three. And we were finally stationed at Camp 4, which is called South Col, which is at 26,000 feet inside an area called the Death Zone. The reason it's called the death zone is because scientists have figured out that above 26,000 feet, human bodies cannot naturally acclimatize and cannot acclimatize even with the help of oxygen bottles. Every second you spend inside the death zone, you are on borrowed time. You have to get to the top as quickly as you can, get down as quickly as you can, and get out of the death zone. Otherwise, it's called the death zone. So there is a good chance that you may probably end up dying and, you know, staying there forever. Like the other 150 climbers whose bodies are in the death zone. So we were here at on May 18th at 9:30 in the night, Mingma Tenzi Sherpa, my Sherpa guide, and also the expedition big boss and me, both of us started our final journey to get to the top of Mount Everest. And we climbed for about 10 hours through the night. On that day, there were almost 250 people attempting to climb to the top of Mount Everest, which also meant that there were a lot of traffic jams on the mountain. We have always heard of traffic jams in Delhi and Mumbai, but, you know, traffic jams on Mount Everest was kind of a very first for me. I was stuck in traffic jams for almost about 4.5 hours behind a very slow Japanese climber. Luckily, I was able to overtake him and finally get to this point from where the photo is being taken. This is also known as the South Summit. And from here to get to the top of Mount Everest is another 2 hours of climbing. But when I got here, I have a very interesting kind of a story to share. As soon as we looked at the top of the mountain, in this photo, you can see there are about 35 to 40 climbers who are coming down. And I was the only one who was going up. And I quickly realized that none of these 35 climbers are going to let me pass. If the people behind me, we were about 15 of us together, I'm like, if 15 of us try and pass these 35 climbers, they are not going to let us pass. And this was a time where I'm running out of oxygen. I'm feeling cold. And there is a good chance that if I make any mistake here in terms of my decision making, then I'm potentially either end up going to lose fingers or toes or end up, you know, dying. So my Sherpa and I actually took a step back. And we thought, look, there's 35 climbers coming down. We are 15 of us. But imagine if we are just two of us, then they cannot, you know, say no to two people. They can definitely say no to 15 people, but they will never say no to two people. So my Sherpa and I devised a tactic where my Sherpa bumped up my oxygen cylinder to at the rate of 4. And when the oxygen cylinder goes to the rate of 4, that means that I would have that extra boost of oxygen and I would be able to go much faster, creating a separation between me and the 13 people behind. So that was the strategy. The only problem is if I used too much oxygen and ran out of it, then I could potentially again end up in trouble where I could end up dying. But this was a very, very calculated gamble, a calculated risk, because I knew that I was very strong and I knew that I had enough oxygen. We bumped it up to 4. We created separation between us and the group behind us, because I went very fast along with my Sherpa. And the moment we approached the first group out of this 35 climbers, they looked at us and they said, two climbers. So I remember, you know, the guy ahead said, ajao, ajao, you know, like, you know, come up, you know, no problems. And the moment we crossed, you know, that first batch, it was superb. After that, everyone allowed us to cross them. And within almost half an hour, we had crossed all the traffic. And we bumped down my oxygen again to 2. There was enough oxygen for me to get to the top, spend 20, 30 minutes on the top and get back down safely. So again, you kind of, you know, have to, in some sense, you know, one of my biggest learnings from this specific incident or many such incidents on the mountains are, you are constantly making decisions on the mountains about your own wellness, about your own life, about your own limbs, about your brain, about your lungs, about everything. And yes, a lot of this decision making depends on what your training, what your experience has been. But a lot of decision making also depends on what your team is. In my case, it was me and my Sherpa Mingma Tenzi, and his experience mattered big time in this case specifically, because he knew exactly what my abilities are. And he was kind of, you know, able to devise this strategy. And we were able to pull it off and we were able to make it to the top. And I remember when I made it to the top, I was literally, you know, like him, me, Mingma and a couple of other guys. The entire summit of Mount Everest, it was only 4 or 5 people of us. And there was this massive traffic jam behind that did not even make it to the top for the next 2 hours. So it was this brilliant masterstroke by Mingma. And of course, I was able to execute his, you know, strategy and his vision. But kind of, you know, shows that there could be a lot of situations that may happen on the mountain. You have to adapt. You have to pivot. You have to figure out how you are going to still keeping the goal the same. How are you going to get to the goal, but in a slightly different way? So that's what we did. We made it to the top. And you must be very surprised at the title of this slide where I'm saying, did I accomplish my dream? After all, I'm standing on the top of Mount Everest. You know, how could you know this be that I've not accomplished my dream here? I want to do share another short backstory, and I'm not going to take a lot of your time. But in 2002, I went vegan. And vegan is someone who's a vegetarian, but someone who does not eat eggs, dairy products, someone who does not wear leather, someone who does not wear wool, someone who does not wear silk, someone who does not consume any animal products in any fashion, animal or animal byproducts in any fashion. And for me, this was a personal ethical choice. I am not standing here and preaching to you guys, please go vegan, please go vegan. That is not what I'm here for. I'm just saying why I made a certain choice. And for me, this choice was driven by my compassion towards animals and my ethics towards animal rights. And that is why I made a choice to not use any animal products. Unfortunately, 14 years later, when I was standing on top of Everest, this one piece jacket that I was wearing on my body, this orange color jacket that you see, this jacket is made from the feathers of a slaughtered duck, or feathers of many slaughtered ducks, unfortunately. And the problem is that this is the only jacket available in the world that can withstand minus 50 degrees Celsius temperatures and 100 kilometer per hour winds on top of Mount Everest. There is simply no jacket available on the planet that is made from animal-free material that could stand on top of Everest. That was a big problem. In 2012, I wrote to many companies asking to make this jacket for me. 2013, 2014, 2015, I was relentless. Every company that you can imagine on the planet, I have written to them. I have asked them to make this jacket. But everyone told me, Kuntal, you are the only human in the world demanding this jacket. It is financially not viable. The technology is not available. It's just not possible. And I made one time compromise with, very ashamed to say this, but I made one time compromise with my ethics. I wore this jacket because I wanted to prove to the world that even on a vegan diet, people can climb to the top of Mount Everest, and that it is very possible that you don't need to eat meat or you don't need to consume animals to achieve superhuman feats. That is what I wanted to prove to the world. But today, as I look back upon this climb, I truly believe this was one of the biggest failures of my life. I should not have compromised with my ethics. I should have persevered. I should have tried harder. After this day, Dr. Chaturvedi mentioned in the beginning that I have addressed many conferences. And I remember that anytime I went to a conference, they would announce that I'm the first vegan in the world to climb Mount Everest. When I went on the stage, mera zameer hamesha khatakta tha. You know, I will use a Hindi word because I truly feel it, denotes what my emotion is about this whole field. Mera zameer khatakta tha kyunki mujhe pata tha I'm not the first vegan in the world to climb Everest. If I wore this jacket made of dead animals, then I was not the first vegan to climb, Everest. And wo zameer khatakne ke wajah se I lost my sleep. And I lost my sleep for a very long period of time until I decided I'm going to do something about it. I am going to try harder. I should not have given up. So now the next thing I can do is I will try harder. I wrote to a company called Save the Duck in 2017. And I said, I want to climb to the Everest. Can you just give me your synthetic material? I will build the suit on my own. Mere paas ek khud ka tailor hai Kathmandu mein. Main sab kuch khud bana lunga. To my surprise, they got back to me saying, we will create a suit for you. We are very, very positive about our technology. For the next 10 months, there was a lot of research and development, a lot of back and forth. And the first synthetic suit of the world was created. The only problem was, how do you test this suit? The material of the suit had never been tested in temperatures of even minus 5 degrees Celsius. So yahan to main minus 50 degree ki baat kar raha hu. But I decided that this time I am going to be the guinea pig myself. I made a mistake in 2016, and the least I can do is rectify that mistake by testing it on myself. And yes, I would be risking my fingers, I would be risking my toes, I would be risking my life. There was a lot at risk, but this time around, I was willing to do it. And I was willing to do it for the animals because this is, you know, the cause that is very near and dear to my heart. And so I decided that I'll climb Mount Lhotse, which is also the fourth tallest mountain in the world. At 28,000 feet, it is only 1,000 feet shy of Everest. But the reason I chose Lhotse is because it does not have any drama that is associated with Everest. If I had gone on Everest and if something had happened to me, then press makes a big deal out of it. They would have said vegan went on Everest and died because he was climbing, you know, wearing this suit or something. And I didn't want any of that drama. I didn't want any of that pressure. My only goal was to go and test this suit and test it thoroughly. And on May 15, 2018, I was standing on top of Lhotse in minus 35 degrees Celsius in air, which is only 30% oxygen. And I was cozy and I was warm. And at that time, I knew it is now time to achieve the biggest dream of my life, which is climbing Everest in 100% vegan fashion. And so finally, I decided, but before that, one of my final takeaways, which is failure is inevitable. If there is one thing that I can guarantee on a stamp paper and attach my paycheck to it and tell everyone here, you are going to fail in life. 150%, 250%, you are all going to fail in life. And most of you have already failed in life, which is why you are here, which is why you have succeeded, which is why you are at the Everest of your lives. So what we can learn from this is that we need to be positive about failure. We need to use it as a learning opportunity. We need to use it as an opportunity to grow, to innovate. And in my case, I innovated. And also, you know, you need to focus on quality, not just, you know, like mindless innovation. Because in this case, even my life depended on it. So I do think that it is important to learn from your failures because failure is going to happen and use it as a way to succeed in life. So this is a very, very big takeaway for me. Finally, I decided I'm going to climb Everest again in 2019. But this time I decided I will climb Everest from the Chinese side. And a lot of people ask me, why did you choose Chinese side? Well, for one, Chinese side is harder. Chinese side is colder and Chinese side is windier. So I thought if I can test the suit in some of the harshest conditions on the planet, then I can prove beyond doubt that a vegan lifestyle, a vegan diet and a vegan gear works 100%. And so I had to do it in the hardest possible fashion. And so I climbed from the Chinese side and this time around phase one, perfect. Stage two, perfect. Stage three, we were amazing. 90% finished, hardly any events. At about 9:30 on 22nd May, we started our journey. For the first 4 hours, we climbed through some very, very pitch darkness. It is so pitch dark when we are climbing that if I turn my headlamp off and if I even put my hand in front of my face, I can't even see my hand. I can't even see the outline of my hand. It is that pitch dark. You're literally just, you know, climbing in that level of darkness most of the times. And I still remember after about 4 hours, I saw my first dead body. On the north side of the mountain, there are almost 11 dead bodies on the summit route. And I remember seeing the first dead body. The guy's entire face was turned. His back was probably broken. So his entire back was broken. And it was a very, very gruesome dead body that I ran into. And the first thing I told Mingma is, let's stay focused. Let's, you know, like get to the top without any mistakes. Because if I make any mistake, mera body bhi idhar isi body ki tarah pada rahega zindagi bhar. And maybe fir kisi newspaper mein ye ban jaunga, ek statistic ban jaunga puri zindagi bhar. And I don't want to become that. And so we climbed through the night and about at 4 in the morning or 3:30 in the morning, we reached this place called the second step. Second step is also this massive 50 feet ka ek rock wall hai, 90 degrees ka. It's almost like you are faced with a 4-floor building in front of you. And when I looked at that 4-floor building, in the entire 10-year journey, this is the first ever time in my life I actually thought I need to give up, that I should give up, that I should just turn around and go home. I was thinking to myself, main ye sab kyun kar raha hu? You know, ye 50 feet ka rock wall 28,800 feet pe aa gaya hai. I have no energy left. I have nothing left. You know, let's just turn around. Let's just go home. Why this madness? What am I doing here? Why am I even here for in first place? What do I have to prove to anyone? Everest to already main chad chuka hu, itne pahad chad chuka hu duniya mein. But then kind of you always go back to the why of why you are doing it. And for me, those why is a very personal and a very spiritual journey. And this time around, I had a very special why, which is I was doing it for the animals. And I told myself, this is it. Ye last step hai. One step in front of another. Bas yahi karna hai. And from there on, for the next 2 hours, all I did was ek step, ek step, ek step. And at 5:30 the morning, I was standing on the very top of Mount Everest. And this time, truly speaking, I had actually achieved the biggest dream of my life. And so I took out a vegan flag and I flew it on the top, knowing that no animal had to suffer or die for my dream to come true. And this kind of almost brings me to my penultimate takeaway, which is one of the biggest learnings from my journey. Do not give up. I went to climb Everest in 2014. I failed. I went to climb Everest in 2015 again and I failed again. If I had given up, I would have never gotten to the top of Mount Everest. And so one of the biggest things is don't give up. Persevere through all these challenges, through all this adversity, through all these failures. And if I can give you one tip, if you have put in absolute amount of effort and dedication into your journey and you are ready to give up, I can tell you that you are very near the top. If you have done everything right and if you have put in the time, if you have put in the effort, you are very near the top. Just persevere for a bit more. Just continue for a bit more. Put in that hard work. I'm pretty sure you will get to the top. Just, you know, to give that example of the wall that I looked at and I said, I'm going to give up. From that wall, it was just a mere 2 hour climb to the top of Everest. If I had given up, pure 3 saal ki mehnat ek jhatke mein sari pani mein chali jati thi. So, wo jo last moment hai when you are, you know, almost ready to give up, don't. Just persevere a little bit more and you will get to the top. And in the beginning, Dr. Chaturvedi had also mentioned about teamwork and the importance of teamwork and how we need leadership in all fields of life. I also think that a lot of people, when they view mountaineering, especially, they think that mountaineering is not a team sport. They think that mountaineering is all about individual accomplishments. And that, you know, in some sense, media kind of makes that out, because every time they make a newspaper article about me, they'll always say, Bombay boy plants the top on, you know, flag on top of Everest, or Kuntal Joshar climbed Everest. But they never talk about my team. They never talk about people who actually put me on top of Everest. And believe me, mountaineering is a big time team sport. And I wanted to take this time to express my gratitude towards my team and also introduce my team to you. And I will start with this first guy. His name is Yost Kabush. He is also the same guy who in 2015 earthquake had the presence of mind to open his jacket and say, Kuntal, you can come inside my jacket and breathe. And it is because of his presence of mind that I am alive today. And for the rest of my life, I'll be indebted to him for, you know, what he did for me. This is my mother and this is my wife. Two of the strongest women I know, without whose love, without whose support, I would absolutely have never made it to the top of Mount Everest. I'm just going to take 30 seconds and give some background. But in 2001, my dad was diagnosed with a disease called Lewy body dementia, which unfortunately took away all his independence. For 19 years, he was afflicted with this disease. To a point where he was bedridden for the last 7-8 years. I was his primary caregiver, but when I was climbing mountains away sometimes for 4-5 months in a year, my wife became his primary caregiver, and she would put a diaper on him, she would bathe him, she would feed him, she would put him to sleep. She literally treated my dad like her own firstborn child. And this is the kind of love and support which, you know, put me on top of Everest. I mean, in some sense, probably she sacrificed the 10 prime years of our marriage. Because look, I come from a Gujarati family, so I also had an arranged marriage. And when we got married, my wife knew me as a software engineer. And then suddenly I got married and, oh, and now I'm going to climb mountains. And then 10 years of my life, you know, of our first 10 years of our marriage, she kind of, you know, supported me in my dream and my journey. So, yeah, they are, you know, part of my team as well. And last but surely not the least, this is my Sherpa guide. His name is Mingma Tenzi Sherpa. And believe me, it would be an understatement to say that I climbed to the top of Mount Everest on Mingma's back. Mingma, these are truly the heroes and the Superman of Himalaya. They do everything for us, including creating the route, setting up the tents, cooking our food, walking with us to the top of Mount Everest. Without Mingma, I would simply have never made it to the top of Mount Everest. And I have been climbing now with Mingma for the last 6 years. He is my family away from home. He is my mentor. He is my guide. He is my brother. He is my friend. He is my everything while we are on the mountain. And without his support, I would simply never make it to the top of Mount Everest. So something, you know, a very big takeaway also has been, when you are on an impossible looking journey like Everest, please surround yourself with a team that you can depend on when things go wrong. That is super, super, super important. So in that sense, teamwork is hypercritical. And so kind of, you know, just going to recap the journey that I have shared until now, which starts with finding your Everest, finally taking that first step, overcoming that first hump, overcoming that hesitation. Or, you know, everyone has that mindset that kya ho gaya agar main fail ho jaunga to, overcoming that fear of failure and showing up, then going forward and training and preparing yourself so that you can give yourself the best chance to succeed and get to the top. So no shortcuts to the top in that sense. Keeping a positive mindset throughout, there's going to be tons and tons of adversity, tons and tons of challenges through any Everest journey. You have to be ready to, you know, constantly adapt and pivot while keeping the goal still the same. And as, you know, I was describing that you need to learn from your failures, use that as a stepping stone for success. And there's going to be a lot of times where you feel like you want to give up. It will happen many, many times. But just persevere, stay focused on your dream and use teamwork for your success. Surround yourself with, you know, great people. Surround yourself with people that are positive. Surround yourself with also people who are not just yes men. You know, haan ye karna hai, haan ye karo, haan ye karna hai. You know, waise bhi log nahi. People who also help, you know, give you, you know, good critical feedback that can help you improve, not only as a leader, but as a climber, as a human being. I think ye sara kuch important hai. So that was kind of, you know, my recap. But one big thing that I constantly, like before I get into my final thought, a big thing that I constantly get asked is, what next? Ab Everest chal liya, ab you know next kya hai? And to everyone, I generally, you know, say, once you climb a mountain, us mountain ke top se hamesha ek dusra mountain dikhne wala hai aapko. Yeah, wo mountain top is probably not the top itself. There's, you know, another top. So every time you reach the top of your Everest, there will be another Everest to climb. There will be another journey to go on. And what is my next Everest? Well, in last couple of years, I have gotten seriously into bodybuilding. And while, you know, a lot of people think bodybuilding is about vanity and bodybuilding is about, you know, just show off and, you know, Instagram pictures, to me, it is not about that. To me, it is a long drawn process, potentially a decade long process of a lot of hard work. Just very, very similar to mountaineering. But both the worlds of mountaineering and bodybuilding are completely 360 degrees pole apart. And they have no common ground whatsoever. And every single human being who I've talked until now from both the fields have said that you cannot be a mountaineer and a bodybuilder at the same time. So I have found my next Everest, which is, you know, yet another impossible journey of combining these two worlds. And doing something that this time around no human has ever done before. Aaj tak kisi pure dunya mein kisi human being ne ye nahi kiya hai. So to me, it is to combine these two worlds. And I'm just going to make an attempt. I don't know whether it is possible. But that's not stopping me from trying it. यू नो उल्टे की मैं तो ऐसी चीज ढूंढता हूँ जो इम्पॉसिबल है, ताकि एटलीस्ट वो जर्नी पे जाके इफ यू कैन मेक इट पॉसिबल ग्रेट, इफ यू कैनॉट मेक इट पॉसिबल स्टिल यू विल लर्न अ थिंग और टू एंड यू विल बिकम अ बेटर वर्जन ऑफ योर सेल्फ. तो ये मेरा मानना है एंड विच इज विथ यू नो आई वुड लाइक टू कम टू माई फाइनल थॉट. In 2016, when I was standing on top of Everest, I suddenly did not become a Zen monk और मुझे कोई निर्वाणा नहीं मिल गया. ओह, मुझे अभी सब कुछ पता चल गया, दुनिया के जो सारे सीक्रेट्स थे अभी मुझे सब पता चल गया एवरेस्ट के टॉप पे. Actually, on the contrary, when I was on top of Everest, for majority of the time, I was just tired, I was exhausted, and I was cold. So I didn't even sometimes feel I enjoyed, you know, all those moments on the top. A lot of the enjoyment is just in the hindsight. But what I truly fell in love with is the process to get to the top, is that journey to get to the top, is that journey from where I went from 110 kg unhealthy Gujarati software engineer to being that guy who created a top of the world mind and body and finally made it to the top of Everest. So that journey and that process is what I really fell in love with and got to the top of Everest. And to me, I think going on these journeys is all about, at the end of the day, I want to become a better version of myself. क्योंकि इस जर्नी के थ्रू जाते हो, जो फेलियर्स, जो एडवर्सिटीज, जो डिफिकल्टीज आती है, टू ओवरकम दोज डिफिकल्टीज, दैट लर्निंग दैट हैपेंस, थ्रू दैट लर्निंग यू आर ट्रांसफॉर्मिंग योर सेल्फ एंड बिकमिंग दैट बेटर वर्जन ऑफ योर सेल्फ. एंड फ्रेंकली स्पीकिंग, आई थिंक द बिगेस्ट एवरेस्ट ऑफ माई लाइफ टूडे इज एट द एंड ऑफ द डे आई जस्ट वॉन्ट टू बी अ बेटर ह्यूमन बींग compared to what I had been yesterday, and do that every single day. So with this, I would kind of, you know, like to open the present, like, you know, this session to Q&A. But if any of you would really kind of, you know, love to reach out to me, feel free to, you know, follow me on Instagram, WhatsApp me, email me, go on my website. I respond to every single message that I get on Instagram, and I do it personally. I don't have a team or anything. I am an individual, and I will respond to all your messages. And if you have any questions, anything, I'm happy to answer them now, and I'm happy to even answer them offline via any of these mediums. And kind of, you know, I always show this to a lot of people, where, you know, this iceberg thing where people just see, you know, the iceberg on the top. People just see, you know, when you succeeded. Log sirf, you know, mera last video dekhte hain. Oh, Kuntal got to the top of Everest. Arre, but Kuntal ka journey to dekho 2010 se. Kya tha wo 2010 mein aur kya hai wo 2020 mein. So, 10 saal bhi to dekho. Sure, you know, that moments on the top are great and those photos are great. But there is so much hard work. There is so much tears. There is so much failures. Kitne saare difficult moments huye wahan tak pahunchne ke liye. So, कभी आप किसी और की जर्नी के साथ कंपेयर कर रहे हो ना, लाइक फर्स्ट ऑफ ऑल डोंट कंपेयर योरसेल्फ्स टू एनीवन एल्सेस जर्नी, बिकॉज एवरीवन एल्स इज एट अ डिफरेंट स्टेज इन देयर जर्नी. सो जस्ट अपनी जर्नी पे फोकस करो और किसी और की जर्नी से इंस्पायर हो, किसी और की जर्नी से लर्न करो, एंड जस्ट फोकस ऑन बिकमिंग अ बेटर वर्जन ऑफ योर सेल्फ. नॉट हे यार इसका सिक्स पैक है, मुझे 8 पैक करना चाहिए, या यू नो इसके पास ये है तो यू नो इसके पास ऐसी गाड़ी है, मेरे पास ऐसी गाड़ी होनी चाहिए. आई डोंट थिंक दोज आर द थिंग्स यू शुड बी इंस्पायर्ड बाय. गेट इंस्पायर्ड बाय यू नो लाइक यू नो कैरेक्टर ट्रेट्स एंड ट्राई एंड इम्बाइब दोज कैरेक्टर ट्रेट्स इन यू, बिकम अ बेटर वर्जन ऑफ योर सेल्फ, एंड बस अपनी जर्नी चार्ट करो. बस दैट यू नो विद दैट आई वुड काइंड ऑफ यू नो लाइक टू एंड दिस सेशन.
थैंक यू सो मच मिस्टर जोशा फॉर दैट मेस्मराइजिंग सेशन. And if you have a look at the chat window, you already see so many colleagues and students appreciating. It seems that they are already inspired by your experience sharing. And Mr. Harveen Bedi, a senior alumnus, has also written that he is getting goosebumps listening to you. And I have been through the same experience here. So I'm sure your session has kindled some questions amongst these young minds present here, some of whom have already gone through your videos. So we'll take up those questions one by one. Students, please unmute yourself when your turn comes, and please ask. Sakshi, you may begin. Please unmute yourself.
Yes, sir. So thank you so much for this amazing session. We are really grateful that you shared your story with us. So my question is that is there any fear that you still feel like every time you climb? And if yes, what is that fear? If you can share with us.
Before I began the journey of climbing Everest, I had a big fear of heights. And this probably goes back to when I was in 7th standard and I had gone to a kids camp. And while rappelling down a rock cliff, I actually missed my step and I was falling down head first. And if the guide below had not locked me, I would have potentially just crashed into the ground and broken my, you know, skull and probably ended up dying. But it left a lot of trauma in me where I was always fearful of heights. So I remembered 2010, when I decided I'm going to climb Everest, I came home and I'm also thinking, but I have this massive fear of heights. And now I want to climb to the tallest mountain of the world. That, like, you know, does not go, you know, with each other well. But one advice that I can give all of you folks is the way at least I manage my fears is, in that case, what I did is I just, you know, head on confronted my fears. I signed up for a mountaineering course. And I put myself in that situation over and over and over again, where I was actually at exposure, where I was hanging off a wall, 90 degree wall, where I was on real heights and I was looking down. And I kind of realized what happens in my mind and what happens in my body and what happens in those situations and how to deal with it better. And the more practice you do, the more you do that over and over and over and over again, it just becomes second nature to you. So I have not overcome my fear of heights. I still have fear of heights. I still, when I am in a certain situation where I'm hanging off a 70 degree wall with a 3000 feet drop, I still have that fear. It's just that I'm able to better manage that fear. And I know what's going to happen. I know there's going to be a lot of chaos. There's going to be a lot of panic the moment I find myself in that situation. But I also know that if I wait for a few seconds, that all that chaos and fear is going to give way to a lot of calm. And when it comes to that calm, I can make my decisions rationally. I can think rationally. I can be objective. Otherwise, if you are making decisions in chaos and panic, it's, you know, like, you know, shooting, you know, bullets in, you know, dark, you know, kuch bhi kar rahe ho tum, you know, laga to laga, jackpot varna nahi laga. But when, you know, your mind is calm and you are able to think objectively and make proper decisions, you are kind of giving yourself the best chance to succeed. So, mera fear management ka yehi strategy hai. Put yourself in that situation. Figure out how you work in that situation. And either you rectify it or you kind of just deal with it. And the way I've done it is I just deal with it. Mujhe pata hai fear aur panic hone wala hai, chaos hone wala hai. But mujhe pata hai ki it will also give way to a very, very calmer me. And that I just need to wait for that. And that is the right time to make decisions. So I still feel fear. Abhi bhi main chote ek one day ke bhi trek pe jata hun. I have done 1,000+ treks near here in Mumbai in the last 12 years. It's like almost I'm doing 100 treks a year sometimes. If one trek every fourth day is, you know, what my life looks like. But even on these treks, sometimes, you know, when I'm hanging off a rock, I'm like, shit. And I'm like, calm down. You know, it's like, you know, 10 seconds and I'll be there. And so, bus, you know, that's what I will say. And practice, practice, practice. Karte raho, karte raho, karte raho. Relentless. You know, to a point where it just becomes second nature. Aaj agar itne treks hai na Bombay mein, jo agar mujhe raat ke 2 baje bhi usme dal diya na, mere aankh pe patti dal ke, I know right, left kahan hai. I know kaise, you know, main top pe pahunch jaunga. So, be that way and believe me, it may not be applicable to all situations in life, but, you know, to fair bit of situations, ye chal jayega.
Thank you, sir. You're right that only option to face the fear is to just go through it. Thank you so much, sir.
Next question, please.
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah.
Sir, there are times when even leaders face such a lot of challenges and issues in life, which disturbs their emotional state and may lead to self-doubts and depression. How do you think leaders should handle such situations and maintain their composure during such times?
Got it. I can tell you how I did that. And you know, whatever you can infer out of it. For me, I think a lot of this, and I've gotten this question quite often, and repeatedly in most of my talks, I say that for me, my positivity, my focus, my drive, and staying away from negativity or staying away from these states where I'm feeling down. And it's not like ke main koi perfect, you know, role model that main kabhi down nahi hota hun ya aisa kuch bhi nahi hota hai. But I try and first of all prevent getting into those situations in first place. And even when I get into those situations, in every single time, I have used my goal and my dream as a driving force. I know that my goal is to climb Everest. And the way I'm built probably is where main wo ghoda hun jiske aage, you know, blinders lag gaye. Aur us ghode ko sirf Everest dikh raha hai. And main wake up karta hun, I may not be motivated at all. I may feel like garbage. I will still show up, still hit the gym, still go do that trek. Trek karne ke liye tumhe subah 4 baje uthna padta hai. 2.5 ghante ka local train ka ride karke base village pahunchna padta hai. Wahan pure din ka trek karke ghar aana padta hai. And sometimes you wake up in the morning and you are like, bahut barish gir raha hai. Yaar pair mein thoda dukh raha hai. Ye ho raha hai, wo ho raha hai. You are, you know, trying, kind of, you know, trying to give that excuse to yourself ki yaar chhod yaar so jata hun. Raat ko 2 baje soya, wo 4 baje uth gaya hun, abhi 2 ghante ka sleep mila hai. So you are trying to, you know, build up all those things in your mind to, you know, chhodo yaar. But in spite of all that, or despite of all that, I will force myself to show up, put that effort, go in, do that trek, because I know that ek baar maine, you know, us cheez mein give up kar diya hai, maine bola haan chalo yaar so jata hun. That will happen quite regularly, and that will kind of take away me from my dream. And so when, you know, it comes situations where I'm feeling like really, really down, or where I'm, you know, really not feeling, you know, the best, you know, in a very positive mindset, I still show up. I still put in the work. The work may not be the best effort that I put in. It may still be half-assing, maybe a workout, or, you know, just going through motions on the trek. But just that, just the fact that I showed up and put in that time and put in that effort actually, you know, kind of inspires me to get out of that rut and stay focused on my dream, and, you know, keep kind of, you know, going on that dream. So I don't know, you know, in leadership scenario mein kaisa hai, main mere personal scenario ki baat kar sakta hun, aur mere personal scenario mein my dream is what, you know, drives me. It does not let me fall into these, you know, traps. A, like, you know, jahan main ekdam, you know, bahut hi sad ho gaya hun, bahut depressed ho gaya hun, it sab, you know, usme jana mein deta hi nahi hai, and kind of, you know, keeps me focused. But at the same time, these journeys can emotionally like hammer you a lot. I remember in 2019 when I came back after climbing Everest, for 2-3 months I was directionless in life. I am like, yaar life mein kuch bacha hi nahi hai, goal khatam ho gaya, sab khatam ho gaya. I am like, kya ho gaya ye zindagi ko yaar, kyun aisa ho raha hai zindagi, what is going on? Like, where, like, I am so goal driven or so target driven sometimes that it was really, really tough situation to cope up with. That is when I actually decided that I'm going to change the goalpost altogether. Rather than having goals always in life to keep me focused and to keep me on this journey, I decided that the biggest goal of my life is now to just show up every day and at the end of the day, be a better version of myself. Even if it's, you know, just by 0.1%. So now I'm no longer, you know, us relentless, you know, mode mein jahan, haan, abhi naya dream dundo, abhi naya dream dundo, abhi naya dream dundo. Gaya life se wo nikal gaya hai. Now I show up every day just because I want to be a good version of myself. Bas, khatam. You know, goalpost hi change kar diya maine. So those are the kind of, you know, stories I can share from my journey. You can, you know, probably, I think they should be applicable to your journey as well.
Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thank you.
Next question, please.
Good afternoon, sir. First of all, I would like to thank you so much for your sharing your amazing journey with us, and there could not be a better way to launch our lead course. Sir, what you have achieved is inspirational. Your journey from being working on systems to getting over the top of the world would always motivate us. But I want to ask, how do you feel now whenever you get the opportunity to motivate us from your life experiences to come out of our comfort zone and achieve those challenges that we are facing?
See, one thing I kind of look back upon me as when I was your age. यार अगर मैं आपके एज का होता और मेरे कॉलेज में भी कोई ऐसे आके यू नो ये सब यू नो शेयर करता मेरे साथ तो प्रोबेबली माय जर्नी वुड हैव बीन अ लॉट बेटर इन द सेंस कि मैं बहुत सारी मिस्टेक्स नहीं करता जो मैंने मेरी जर्नी में की. तो वन थिंग दैट इज रियली रियली इम्पॉर्टेंट फॉर मी इज टू गिव बैक टू द कम्युनिटी इन वॉट एवर वे आई कैन एंड दोज वेज आर इफ आई कैन इंस्पायर टू फाइंड योर एवरेस्ट एंड गो ऑन दिस जर्नी. आई थिंक अगर मैं इवन लाइक स्मॉल कैटलिस्ट का भी रोल प्ले कर दूं तुम्हारे जर्नी में या यू नो एवरीवन हूज यू नो अटेंडिंग राइट नाउ अगर आपके जर्नी में मैंने जरा भी छोटा रोल भी प्ले कर दिया दैट यू नो वो स्पार्क आ गया यार ओके नहीं यार आई एम जस्ट यू नो नाउ गोइंग टू डू इट दैट वुड बी यू नो काफी लोग यू नो लेगेसी के बारे में बात करते हैं फेम नेम पैसा यार अगर किसी लेगेसी के साथ जाना है ना तो आई थिंक ये लेगेसी बहुत अच्छा होगा. Yeah, you know, I inspired people to find their Everest and climb their Everest. I think that is the legacy I would like to probably, you know, leave with whenever that happens. Hopefully that will happen, you know, when I'm 90 and 100 and I have climbed Everest maybe another 10 times, hopefully, or many more mountains. But yeah, so it just all goes back that when I was young, when I was 19, when I was 20, when I was 21, there was none of this stuff happened. We didn't have, you know, people coming from different facets of life and sharing their journeys and their experiences in our colleges, in our setting. Everything was about academics. And, you know, tabhi to humare paas choice bhi nahi the. Ya to MBA karo, ya to engineer bano, ya to doctor bano. Abhi to, you know, life, you know, pura world different ho gaya abhi to. So, you guys have so much choice. But still, I think if you are exposed to people from different fields coming and sharing their thoughts, you guys will get that perspective यार के academics के भी बाहर कुछ है वहां से भी हम सीख सकते हैं काफी. जैसे starting में ही डॉक्टर चतुर्वेदी ने बोला था कि सिर्फ academics ही नहीं है you know बहुत सारे अलग अलग fields है जहां से बहुत कुछ सीखने के लिए है. So that's all, that is one of the big reasons why I do these talks all the time just so that I can give back. Like ऐसे तो मैं हर जन को मिल नहीं सकता हूँ. So all I can do is I can write on social media about my learnings. Or I can do these talks where I can share my journeys in person with you folks. So that's something, that's the least I can do as a person, at least as a give back to the community. So ye mera angle hai to giving back to the community. And iske liye main sab karta hun.
Thank you so much. It's 12:29, Mr. Joysher. Would you be able to spare 15 more minutes?
Because yeah, sure. Absolutely. Not a problem.
Thank you so much for that opportunity. And could we have the next question, please?
Very good afternoon, sir. I am Jagdeep, a student of PGDM first semester. So my question is, sir, right now it is a life of social media and OTT platforms. Most of the people are glued to their mobiles after the halt of outdoor activities. And, you know, nowadays they get very, they get depressed in every small things. If one thing doesn't get with the flow, they think that it is like their end or something bad happened with that. And by that time, it was not really that bad. So how can they channelize their energies so that they can do something towards their goal and something positive towards their self?
Look, I am going to be practical and say that the world is different today. And I'm not going to, you know, stand here and act like your mother or father and say, yaar, you know, phone chodo, you know, real zindagi jiyo. Main ye sab bolne nahi wala hun, kyunki ye sab koi karne nahi wala hai. You know, aap log social media ki, and I am also, you know, I also live a lot of my life in social media. So, agar main khud hi nahi kar raha hu, to main aapko kaise, you know, kuch suggest karu ki, you know, aray social media chhod do, ya fir, you know, ye chhod do. But yes, I think aajkal kafi sara mindset instant gratification ki taraf, you know, ho gaya hai ke people are like, oh, you know, post kiya, kuch to likes mil gaya, and you know, people are like, you know, then driven by that likes and driven by their life on social media. And you know, balance chahiye, wo bhi karo. As I said, I'm not asking you to kind of, you know, leave off social media. Use social media as a tool to learn a whole bunch of things. Have fun as well, right? Because इफ यू आर जस्ट गोइंग टू बी लर्निंग 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 ऑल द टाइम एंड नॉट हैविंग फन तो यू नो कुछ मजा नहीं आने वाला है, क्योंकि यू विल जस्ट गेट बोरिंग एट अ सर्टेन पॉइंट. तो जो तुम्हें फन करना है करो, यू नो फोटो शेयर करने हैं, वीडियो शेयर करने हैं, यू वेंट टू अ पार्टी, श्योर यू नो शेयर ऑल ऑफ दैट. बट आई थिंक इट्स इंपॉर्टेंट टू काइंड ऑफ डिटैच योर सेल्फ फ्रॉम अ लॉट ऑफ दीज थिंग्स इन टर्म्स ऑफ के यू नो रनिंग आफ्टर लाइक्स, रनिंग आफ्टर कॉमेंट्स, रनिंग आफ्टर यू नो बिल्डिंग लाइक दैट बिग फॉलोइंग. Even when I started out my social media journey and all of those things, I kind of thought, yeah, it would be so cool if I had like a bigger following, then I could, you know, send my message to a lot more people and they would be able to kind of, you know, learn so much more from it. I have detached myself from everything. I no longer care about how many people like my post, how many people comment on my post, how many people follow me. I am absolutely kind of, you know, cheez se maine complete detachment kar liya hai. I've stopped running after any of those things. And mera bahut single-minded focus hai. I am going to use my social media mostly for, you know, multiple things. One is, you know, to share my stories. And two is to track people who I really get inspired from. So, main ensure karta hun ke jo log, you know, agar koi log aisa hai jo mujhe lagta hai ke, you know, always negative hote ya, hamesha, you know, toxic cheezein phailate rehte, main unko just block out kar deta hun. I don't, while you know someone will say ki apna hi bubble create kar diya hai, apna hi positive bubble create kar diya hai, but kabhi kabhi kaisa hota hai na, social media ka space mein mujhe mere zyada energy nahi dalni hai. You know, I would rather have that energy debating, you know, real human beings in my family and my friends and everyone. And social media I have, you know, like one way communication hai almost, jahan main meri cheeze share karta hu aur thode bahut jo logo se main inspire hota hu ya unki information mujhe applicable hai mere life mein, wo sab main track karta hu. But otherwise that's pretty much, you know, how I use social media. I no longer kind of attach it to, are yaar mujhe like mil gaya, are ye ho gaya, are wo, completely usse main nikal hi gaya hu. And which is why you also see the platforms themselves, you know, going towards things like अभी लाइक्स में से नंबर निकाल दो, लाइक्स दिखाने बंद कर दो. यू नो पहले उन्होंने ही किया ये सब, अभी वो लोग यू नो रिवर्स डायरेक्शन में जा रहे हैं. आई यू नो लुक द सोशल मीडिया प्लेटफॉर्म्स आर फिकल, दे विल ऑलवेज यू नो बी गोइंग अप एंड डाउन. आई थिंक यू एज अ पर्सन नीड टू सेट योर बाउंड्रीज, यू एज अ पर्सन नीड टू सेट के तुम्हारे लिए क्या इंपॉर्टेंट है, एंड यू नो काइंड ऑफ जस्ट करते रहो. ये सारी चीजें बहुत डेलिबरेट है. तुम्हें लगता है कि यार हाँ हो जाएगा, एक ही दिन में डिटैचमेंट हो जाएगा. अगर एक दिन में डिटैचमेंट हो जाता है यार, क्या इजी नहीं है इतना सोशल मीडिया से डिटैच होना. सो यू हैव टू प्रैक्टिस दिस ऑन एन ऑन गोइंग बेसिस. एंड एज आई सेड, देयर हैज टू बी अ बैलेंस. इफ यू आर जस्ट गोइंग टू, हाँ मैंने छोड़ दिया सोशल मीडिया, एक महीना छोड़ोगे और जब भी वापस आओगे ना तो डबल सोशल मीडिया करोगे. So rather, you know, keep it, you know, something that is very occasional, and keep it, you know, something that you do in the day, but, and so that you do enough so that you are not kind of getting attached to it. So probably not the best answer you are looking for, but this is something that I do in my life, and even I'm finding it out on an ongoing basis, ke how my relationship with social media is, and you know, wo kaisa ho raha hai, and I am constantly growing and I am constantly improving on this. काफी लोग मुझे हमेशा बोलते हैं अरे यू आर एन इन्फ्लुएंसर ये वो. अभी मैंने रिसेंटली एक पोस्ट लिखा, प्लीज गाइस आई मैं इन्फ्लुएंसर नहीं हूँ, डोंट ट्रीट मी एज एन इन्फ्लुएंसर. यू नो ये लोग प्राइस दे देते हैं, यू नो टॉप 30 इन्फ्लुएंसर ये सब, ए मैं इन्फ्लुएंसर हूं ही नहीं. यू नो मैं उस चीज से मैं निकल गया हूँ, मैं इन्फ्लुएंसर नहीं हूँ. आई एम जस्ट यू नो अ कॉमन मैन हु इज शेयरिंग सम ऑफ हिज स्टोरीज फ्रॉम हिज जर्नी. And if you can find any learnings from that, great. If you don't find any learnings from that, still great. You know, not judging anyone now, us sense mein.
Thank you. Can we have the next question, please, quickly?
Yes, ma'am. A very good afternoon to you, sir. So my question to you is, despite so many obstacles and conflicts, how do you keep yourself motivated, and how do you look up for the inspiration and mentorship?
Two things I'll quickly share here. Again, something I've written. ये सबसे मेरा last post जो मैंने 4 या 5 दिन पहले लिखा है is about motivation. This will come as a surprise to a lot of you people, but motivation is absolutely bullshit emotion. मैं motivation पे depend ही नहीं होता हूँ. Zero dependency on motivation है मेरा. क्यों, मोटिवेशन कैसा है, मतलब आज बहुत सही है, कल जरा भी नहीं है, उसके बाद कहीं बीच में, उसके बाद है ही नहीं, 6 हफ्ते के लिए गायब हो गया, 1 दिन के लिए वापस आ गया. आई डू नॉट डिपेंड ऑन मोटिवेशन एट ऑल. आई शो अप इन द मॉर्निंग, आई पुट द वर्क बिकॉज आई केयर अबाउट माई ड्रीम एंड आई वॉन्ट टू गिव माई सेल्फ द बेस्ट चांस टू सक्सीड ऑन दैट ड्रीम. एंड फॉर दैट आई डोंट नीड एनी एक्सटर्नल मोटिवेशन. हाँ, आज सुबह मैंने ना बियर बाइसेप्स का यू नो अच्छा वीडियो देखा, आई एम नाउ पम्प्ड. कितने दिन पंप हो गए किसी का वीडियो देख के, कितने दिन यू नो क्या किसी के बुक पढ़ के पंप होने वाले हो. द जर्नी, माई जर्नी वॉज अ 12-year जर्नी. यू कांट यूज मोटिवेशन इन अ 12-year लॉन्ग जर्नी. एंड बिलीव मी, मोस्ट वर्थ जर्नीज आर गोइंग टू रन इन टू डेकेड्स. दे आर नॉट गोइंग टू रन इन टू वीक्स और मंथ्स, दे आर गोइंग टू रन इन टू डेकेड्स, प्रॉब्ली मल्टीपल डेकेड्स. फॉर एग्जाम्पल डॉक्टर चतुर्वेदी's जर्नी, राइट, इट हैज बीन अ मैसिव मल्टी 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 डेकेड लॉन्ग जर्नी. So he, if he was dependent on motivation every morning, kaise hota, you know, kaise is level tak wo pahunchte, right? So that is what I would kind of suggest. Don't depend so much on motivation. I don't depend on motivation at all in that sense. I have, you know, kind of detached myself from motivation. Rather, I put in the work despite the lack of motivation many, 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 many times, including today I have to go work out right after, you know, I finish the talk. And I am sore across my entire body. I'm zero motivated, you know, to put the workout in. But I'm still going to go and do the workout because I know that that is going to add a little bit towards my dream. So that is, you know, the mindset I have. And who do I look up for inspiration and wo sari cheeze? For example, when I'm on the mountain, I am highly inspired by my Sherpa guide, Mingma Tenzi Sherpa. The level of preparedness that he comes with. You know, मैं आपको एक इंसिडेंट बताऊंगा. मैं कैंप 2 से कैंप 3 के बीच में एवरेस्ट में चढ़ रहा था. मेरे आगे 50 क्लाइंबर का लाइन होगा एंड मिंगमा के पास अबाउट 55 केजी का बैग था क्योंकि उसमें दो बड़े बड़े टेंट थे, 6 या 7 ऑक्सीजन की बॉटल थी, बहुत सारा खाना था एंड मिंगमा मेरे साथ चल रहा था. और मैंने मिंगमा को बोला, यार मिंगमा मेरे साथ मत चलो क्योंकि मैं इंडिपेंडेंट क्लाइंबर हूं, मैं अकेला चल लूंगा मेरे स्पीड पे, तुम जाओ आगे. Half an hour later, Mingma had crossed all the 50 climbers. Mingma was not even sucking on oxygen. All the 50 climbers were sucking on oxygen. 50 kilo ke back ke saath usne sabko overtake karke wo sabke upar tha aur wo gaya upar. By the time I reached the campsite, he had already set up the 2 camps and he had already food ready. When I see this stuff, I am like, man, this guy is amazing. I need to be, you know, this level. Or I need to aspire to this level. Main pahunchunga nahi us level pe, mujhe pata hai. क्योंकि वो अलग लेवल, वो अलग प्लैनेट से है, मैं अलग प्लैनेट से हूँ, यू नो, उस लेवल का डिफरेंस है हम दोनों के बीच में. बट मैं अस्पायर तो कर सकता हूँ. और उस, सो व्हेन आई गो बैक होम, आई नो यार मिंगमा इज गोइंग टू कम फ्रिकिंग प्रिपेयर्ड. आई नीड टू ट्रेन हार्डर, आई नीड टू शो अप, आई नीड टू बी एट द बेस्ट वर्जन ऑफ माई सेल्फ. जब भी मैं आऊँ तो मिंगमा मुझे देख के बोले, यार इस टाइम तो यू आर, यू नो, कम लाइक रियली नाइस एंड यू नो लाइक प्रिपेयर्ड. सो आई यू नो ट्रूली गेट इंस्पायर्ड फ्रॉम पीपल आई नो, people I deal with on a daily basis. Those are the people I get inspired from because those are the people I can really identify with in some sense. And Mingma is definitely one of them. And to share with everyone, earlier this January, one of the last bastions of mountaineering that had not been finished by human beings, which is climbing the K2 in winter. 32 years se log K2 time, K2 kar rahe, climb winter mein. और कोई भी सक्सीड नहीं हो रहा है. बट दिस जनवरी मिंगमा मेड इट टू द टॉप ऑफ K2 इन विंटर, बिकमिंग द फर्स्ट एवर ह्यूमन बीइंग ऑन द प्लैनेट टू डू अ फीट लाइक दैट. उस माउंटेन को लोग समर में भी नहीं क्लाइम कर पाते, उस बंदे ने विंटर में क्लाइम किया इन टेम्परेचर्स ऑफ -65 -70. एंड सो यू नो दैट इज द गाय आई गेट इंस्पायर्ड फ्रॉम. ही इज माय क्लाइंबिंग पार्टनर, ही इज माय क्लाइंबिंग मेंटर, ही इज माय क्लाइंबिंग गुरु इन एवरी वे. 6 साल से हम लोग साथ में कर रहे हैं. सो ही इज माय बिग इंस्पिरेशन.
थैंक यू सो मच. एंड आई एम अफ्रेड वी हैव टाइम फॉर जस्ट वन लास्ट क्वेश्चन.
यस, हेलो, गुड आफ्टरनून सर. फर्स्टली थैंक यू सो मच फॉर दिस वंडरफुल सेशन. सो माय क्वेश्चन इज, पीपल टॉक सो मच अबाउट द सेरेनिटी एट माउंटेन्स इन कंपैरिजन टू कॉर्पोरेट्स. But what are the similarities and challenges you feel there that is at mountains and corporates?
What is the similarities? There have been lots, challenges. Right. There have been lots and lots of articles written about parallels between the mountaineering world and the corporate world, things like risk management, things like decision making in microseconds, jahan apne life jab maine bhi baat kiya, decision making ke bare mein, and kafi sare parallels, but I'm going to talk about an aspect that has not been talked about quite often. In 2009, I used to work as a director of India operations of a software company, which were, the child company was here in Mumbai and the parent company in Los Angeles. One of the big reasons why I was hired was because I fit the profile that they were looking for, like a guy who's high IQ, but who is very low in patience. Someone who they consider a go-getter, someone who will always be like impatient and finding something to do, kind of dynamic startup environment. So, generally, sare life aise hi jagah pe hire hua hu, because wo, profile maine fit kar liya tha acche se. And then I went to climb mountains, and then I suddenly realized that in mountains you have no control over anything. You have no control over the end result. You have no control over your own life. You have no control over when you are going to get to the top. Itna ego ka hai na, dhajia ud jata hai na mountains mein. Itna matlab obliteration hota hai na ego ka, ke tum, you come to know what you are in real sense. So tum pure ground pe aa jate ho. Tum hawa mein ud rahe ho. Oh, I am the director of India operations. Oh, I am doing this. Oh, I am doing that. And then bang, you suddenly are coming to the ground. You are nothing when you are in the mountains. Mountains is everything in sense mein. So, one of the biggest things that I learned in the mountains in the last 10 years is the game of patience. And something I truly, truly wish that a lot of younger generation starts learning, because ye lambi journeys mein bahut zyada patience ka khel hai, bahut zyada. You can, force matters as much as you want. Like today I see a lot of people who are gymming and they are like, oh, but if I do more, if I do more workout, I'll, be more jacked. I will be more big. And I'm like, that's not how it works. That's not how anything works. You have to be patient. You have to be patient for that long, long, long time period. So I truly feel that ab ke aur us kuntal ke beech mein patience ka bahut bada difference hai. That kuntal, if someone did not do their work, I would most definitely get into a verbal match with them. Like, सुनाने में मैं पीछे नहीं हटता था. किसी ने एक क्वेश्चन दोबारा पूछा ना, मैंने आंसर दिया और दोबारा पूछा ना, मतलब वो पर्सन तो गया काम से. अभी कोई क्वेश्चन मुझे पूछेगा ना, 100 बार भी पूछेगा ना, मैं 100 बार आंसर दूंगा उसको. इतना पेशेंस है मेरे में. मैं ऐसे नहीं बोल रहा हूँ कि 100 बार आंसर देना इज अच्छी बात, क्योंकि तुम 100 बार आंसर दे रहे हो, समझ नहीं आ रहा है तो कहीं प्रॉब्लम है, या तो तुम्हारे में या तो उसमें. But I'm just saying that I have that level of patience now that I will, look at things very differently than that 10-year ya 12 saal pehle wala kuntal karta tha. And mountains teach you patience, because if you are not patient, you will never climb a mountain in your life. And I think that is even applicable to every facet of your life, because as Dr. Chaturvedi rightly pointed out in the beginning, that we all are climbing our personal Everests. We all are climbing our personal mountains. तो अगर वो माउंटेन चढ़ना है तो पेशेंस के साथ चढ़ो. बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट है वो ख्याल में रखना, ध्यान में रखना. सो या दैट्स माय वन टेक इन द काइंड ऑफ सिमिलैरिटी बिटवीन द वर्ल्ड्स ऑफ कॉर्पोरेट एंड द माउंटेन्स. आई विश देयर वर मोर कॉर्पोरेट्स दैट वर मोर पेशेंट एंड यू नो दैट इनकॉर्पोरेटेड पेशेंस एज देयर कोर वैल्यू होपफुली ऑफ देयर ऑर्गेनाइजेशंस.
Thank you so much, Mr. Joysher, for so patiently responding to all those questions and inspiring our students of this batch. And you'll be glad to know that as part of this course lead, we will be taking our students through this virtual expedition to Mount Everest by way of a Harvard simulation, where they will go through a series of problem solving and decision making challenges. But of course, their experience is going to be nowhere close to the kind of experience, the thrill that you have been through. And very soon we will be sending across to you a small token of our gratitude and appreciation. And my colleague Nishant has just displayed what is coming your way.
Thank you so much. Really, really appreciate that. Thank you.
And may I now request Dr. Anupam Verma, Deputy Director and Dean Academics at BIMTEC, to please deliver the vote of thanks. Verma sir.
Thank you, Dr. Manushi. Our special guest, Mr. Kuntal Joshi, our director, Dr. H. Chaturvedi, other faculty colleagues, dear students and alumni. I had heard about Mr. Kuntal Joshi, who conquered Mount Everest twice and many other top mountain peaks during the last 6-7 years. I had also had the privilege of listening to the TED Talks and some podcasts by him, courtesy our director, who had sent these during the last few days. Without doubt, they were extremely impressive. However, listening to Mr. Kuntal personally today in our own function was a real, real treat. The fantastic experiences he shared were really amazing. I do hope all others present will agree. Mr. Kuntal Joshi has made elaborate mention about his dream of conquering the Everest. He did this twice in 2016 and 2019. His intense focus to achieve his dream is unparalleled. It is rare to find a person who can stay so much focused towards his passion in finding his dream. In the process, he has met with major failures, which would have dissuaded anyone else in giving up on pursuing such passion. The failure included even circumstances which led to abandoning of the expedition due to uncontrollable situation and postponing the whole project for some time. Mr. Kuntal Joshi, however, on the other hand, strategized the planning, adapted to adverse situations with determination, and re-embarked on his journey after some time. Despite all odds towards attaining this success, he has succeeded always. His emphasis on the importance of teamwork and perseverance as important means in achieving one's life's biggest dreams is something to ponder upon and learn from them. Mr. Kuntal also talked briefly about his vegan lifestyle. He is perhaps the only completely vegetarian person who has succeeded in climbing Everest. All literature in the industry pointed to meat, dairy, and eggs being necessary for success. So the odds were totally stacked against him, but he developed and maintained completely vegan style and succeeded to reach the top world. An important highlight of his address today was that he has precisely defined the takeaways. He has also described about the foundation necessary for success in any venture. Our OB and HR department runs a leadership experience and attitude development course, which acts as a laboratory for leadership development. There can't be a better way to launch this course for the new batch of his students. And we are grateful to Mr. Kuntal to do this and be present and guide our students on this occasion. Thank you, Mr. Kuntal.
Thank you so much.
I thank our director and OBHR faculty members who have thought about this idea. I'm sure every student and everyone else present here will benefit from the thought-provoking address by Mr. Kuntal Joshi. That the students have found his talk interesting and thought-provoking is evident by the fact that they have asked such searching questions. Perhaps if more time was available, the Q&A session could have gone much, much longer. I thank the students for their intense interest in the talk and the interactions that followed. Let me also express my gratitude to everyone who is present today to attend this event. Thank you all very much.
Thank you so much, sir. And that brings us to the close of this session. Thank you so much for joining us today and have a great day. And Mr. Joshi will be in touch.
Thank you.